with that outreach yesterday. Would you please stand? We want to recognize you and say thank you. All right, stay standing. Thank you, guys. Yes. Thank you so much. And wow, great presentation. I really appreciate you guys putting that together to share with the congregation. We have many opportunities. If you weren't able to help yesterday, we have many opportunities to be involved this year. So keep looking at the Destiny Times and listening to announcements and paying attention to the website for information on that. So children, you guys can go ahead and head out to Kids Church. Let's hear it for our kids. Getting started a little late this morning, but what a great service. So I will get you out of here by brunch. Breakfast and lunch, yeah. In other words, before 12. Significantly before 12. Okay. Hey, we're doing part four of this this series, Super You. And yeah, I do want to also welcome you if this is your first time here. And or if you're coming back a couple of times, you're like, I don't know about this church. It's a little weird, but something keeps making me come back. I'm afraid I'm falling in. Falling in love. Keep coming back. So we're going to start this message, Super You, saving the world one relationship at a time around this time of the year because you have Mother's Day and Father's Day. I usually try to take time to talk about relationships, and hopefully you haven't been bored with that. I know last Sunday you definitely weren't bored with it. I watched the congregation go like this towards the end of that message like I've never seen it before. I hope you guys have all had a wonderful week, husbands and wives. Gotten a lot of feedback on that message, and I hear things are really on fire. So if you improve your relationships, you will start to achieve true success. I honestly believe that that you're never going to have real success in life unless you learn how to relate with people. And it's very important that you know how to do that. And some of you, I look out, some of you guys are really good at it. Maybe some of you are not good at it. I'm not saying that. But we can all improve in our skills, in our love for people, in our desire to connect and make a bigger difference. And so I want you to think about your relationships. How are your relationships? Are they good? Are they decent? Have you given up? Believe again, man. You can get things going. You have the power. And hey, here's a neat thing. God's grace is available. I believe God is in this message. So I don't talk about relationships. Let's talk about the fire of God. Let's talk about, listen, man, this is the fire of God. You can pray. You can have a great prayer life. But if you're fighting inside of the home, watch what that does to your walk with God. You know, so it's very important that you learn how to relate with people in all the different levels. And, you know, I said that I'm going to help you to save the world one relationship at a time by working on five different types of relationships. And my wife covered the first one. She preached a very humorous message, and it was awesome. And she said that these are the virtues that are common to super moms. Not just super moms, but super parents. We talked about the parental relationship. Patience, yes. Unconditional love and joy. If you want to have a great family, you want to raise a great family. And then I talked about super sidekicks a week after, and I talked about sidekicks always serve a superhero. And so I talked about expressing honor to the mentors in your life, to the bosses, to your parents, to spiritual leaders, to leaders in government, to the people who are responsible for you. And I said that you can do that by these three expressions of honor: humble service, gratitude, and lifetime achievement. What you do with your life will really stand out and bless the people who have planted into you. And then last week I talked about super sweethearts, and I talked about three fundamentals to a romantic relationship, and I talked about commitment, godliness, and sensational intimacy. God bless you all for that. And today I'm going to talk about another fun one. I'm going to talk about super friends. Super friends. And, you know, good friendship is a challenge. People are busy, yes, stressed out, and apt to hurt the people they love. Good people are increasingly self-focused and needy, usually angry or sad, and usually complaining about something. Even good people. There's a little pressure on the world right now. A lot of people are not smart with their money. They're not smart with their time. Margin has been taken away, and most people are running from point A to point B as fast as they can. No time for anyone else. And there's a lot of stressed out people. And so because of that, give people a break. most people are having a breakdown. Yes? Out of survival, a lot of people take more than they'll give to a relationship these days. And that makes it tough to establish relationship. It's more challenging to be a great friend, to find great friends, or to build great friendships. And so much of the time, it will seem like you're casting your pearl before swine. Ryan Huffer did a tweet this week, and he said that something like, on average, every 7 years, you have a whole new set of friends. And I thought how sad that is, because friendship, I believe that friendship is worth the search. It's worth the effort, because a few super friends can change your life. Yes, sure can. I've experienced that in my life. The Bible even says two people are better off than one. They can help each other succeed. Look at somebody next to you and say, help me win. If one falls, then the other one can reach out and help, right? If someone falls alone, but if someone falls alone, he's in real trouble. So if you're alone, you're in real trouble. You've got to start doing something to build friends. And if you want friends, be friendly. That's what the Bible says. He that wants friends should be friendly, right? So we have to learn some of the skills in this to have better friendships. Would you like to have better friendships? Would you like to be a better friend? Yeah. Do you think it can be better? Yeah. Yes, it definitely can. The goal of friendship is to live as more than a hermit. I know you're happy with just you, and you're so perfect that you're afraid to let anybody else into your life to ruin the perfectness of just being with you. But there is another life out there, oh hermit one, beyond, you know, your family room and your Netflix. And God wants you to get out, it's springtime, and go do life with someone. Yes? Definitely. Life is more fun and it's more full when you invite a friend on an adventure. Will you put the effort to build your friendships? Say yes. It takes effort. Check out this clip from Big Bang Theory. It's kind of funny. I condensed it way down.
I've isolated the algorithm for making friends. She's really onto something. We could open a booth at Comic-Con, make a fortune. It's a terrific book. I've distilled its essence into a simple flow chart that will guide me through the process. Have you thought about putting him in a crate while you're out of the apartment? Hello, Kripke. Yeah, Sheldon Cooper here. It occurred to me that you hadn't returned any of my calls because I hadn't offered any concrete suggestions for pursuing our friendship. Yeah, perhaps the two of us might share a meal together. Yeah, I see. Well, then perhaps you'd have time for a hot beverage. Popular choices include tea, coffee, cocoa. I see. No, wait, don't hang up yet. But what about a recreational activity? I bet we share some common interests. You tell me an interest of yours. Really? On actual horses? Tell me another interest of yours. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I have no desire to get in the water till I absolutely have to. Tell me another interest of yours.
Uh-oh, he's stuck in an infinite loop.
I can fix it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, but isn't ventriloquism by definition a solo activity? Yeah. I mean, tell me another interest of yours. Hang on, Kripke. A loop counter and an escape to the least objectionable activity. Howard, that's brilliant. I'm surprised you saw that.
Gee, why can't Sheldon make friends?
Kripke, that last interest strikes me as the least objectionable, and I would like to propose that we do that together tomorrow. Yes, I'll pay. All right, goodbye.
Oh, watch. Oh, no, yeah, he got offered to go rock climbing. So, you know, it does take effort to build friendships. Would you agree with that? Some friendships happen more naturally than others. But when you look at long-lasting friendships, you'll see that there are certain traits that are common to the good ones. And if you want to be a super friend and you want to have super friends, then I think you should learn about it. I can't cover all those traits in one service, but I do want to cover four of them. I believe that if you will develop these four traits in your life, that you'll be a better friend. Would you like to be a better friend? You already told me you would. Say yes again?
Yes.
All right. So here they are. Trait number one is firm loyalty. Loyalty. Say it out loud, loyalty. You know, because many people lack this trait, few friendships, as I said, last more than a few years. Few friendships have a chance to have significant depth. It's no fun when people are constantly going in and out of your life. So when people, for example, when people leave this church sometimes for good reasons, I often think over the years, but what about friendship? What about friendship? Where does that rank in the criteria? Did we matter, or was the relationship no deeper than the quality of our programs? And you have to ask yourself that. And of course, there's definitely nothing wrong with moving around. There's people always going out of our church and coming into our church, and people are shifting around. You got to find the one that works best for you. We don't want to be the church like when you get in, you can't get out. That's a scary thing. That's kind of like what they call a cult. You're free to leave. You're free to come and go. But I would say that when we're talking about the subject of loyalty, I believe loyalty is best understood when you look at the difference between, T.D. Jakes coined the phrase years ago, and it stuck with me, one of the greatest sermons I've ever heard him speak. And he talked about the difference between confidants and constituents. And he uses two C words to kind of blend them. I actually looked at the word for constituent. It just basically means one of the crowd, you know, one of the citizens. But a confidant is much deeper than that. A confidant is, well, as I'll explain here in a minute, is he says things like, you will have only a very few confidants in your life. Confidants love you unconditionally. If you get in trouble, they'll get in trouble with you. If you go to jail, they'll go visit you and cheer you up. If you're in the crack house, they'll go get you out, right? You can share anything with them, and they'll make sure that they're, one of their jobs is to get you into your destiny, to get you, keep you moving forward. And he says, if you have only two or three of those in your lifetime, then you're doing really well. Lester Summerall said he got to the end of his life. He was in his late 80s, and he said, I have traveled around the world. I've met prime ministers, presidents, queens, and kings. And he said, I've only had enough friends to use one hand with a few fingers left over. He said, enough true friends. He was talking about confidants, not constituents, not people that bounce around and they're with you sometimes and they're not with you other times. In John chapter 6, the crowds shifted with the poles. If you remember, Jesus preached a very difficult sermon. He said, if you want to follow me, you need to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And everybody goes, what is he talking about? That sounds nasty. He was talking about the kind of life that they would need to lay down to follow Jesus. He said, it's not easy following Christ, following me. He said, you're going to have to lay your life down, like Aaron was talking about in worship. And you're going to have to pick up your own cross and follow me. Well, in the process of preaching this hardcore sermon, it says that many people got up and said, enough of this. This is too hard. And they left. They walked away from Jesus. Jesus turns to his 12 disciples and says, what about you? Will you leave also? And do you know what the 12 disciples said? Somebody tell me. Where else will we go? Only you have the words of life. And they stayed and they followed Jesus. It's really awesome because this is a great example. Everyone else was walking away, but the 12 demonstrated loyalty that day. They said, Jesus, we'll be with you when you're popular and we'll be with you when you're not popular. Now, you know, Peter ended up blowing it in the loyalty thing, but he got it back together. So if you are blowing it, there is hope. But that day, they stood with Jesus. Here's another example of a confidant. In Ruth, in the book of Ruth, Naomi loses everything. She loses her sons, her husband, and she has two daughter-in-laws left. And one of the Naomi. One of her daughter-in-laws, Ruth, in the Bible, and the book is named after Ruth because of this amazing loyalty and faith that Ruth had. You want to be like Ruth? You should want to be like Ruth. She's one of the greatest Bible characters. She says this. Naomi says, I'll tell you what. I'm going back to my homeland. I have nothing to offer you. Listen, I have nothing to give you. I'm empty. I'm an empty woman. Life is not good for me. You're better off staying here. And you know what Ruth says? Look at this in the Bible. Don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. That sounds kind of creepy, doesn't it? Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried right beside of you. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. Ruth was there not for what Naomi could provide for her. Ruth was there for Naomi. Ruth was there for Naomi and Naomi's God. She connected with God during the time, obviously, with Naomi. And she said, I'm not going anywhere. I'm with you. Look at somebody and say, I'm with you. It felt good just saying it, didn't you? Didn't it? Charlie, I'm with you. And you guys have demonstrated that throughout the years. We've been together for a long time. And I thank God for long friendships. Think all the times that we could have parted ways and been out of each other's lives. You've been through hard times. I've been through hard times. Church been through hard times. But there you still are, right on the front row, smiling away. I mean, I said some really bad things to you in one of my sermons a while back. It worked out for the good. And I got a text from him last week referencing back to that sermon. So those of you who have come all the time, it's a benefit to come to church all the time because then you're on the insider jokes. Okay, look. So constituents, on the other hand, they're not into you. They're not in it for you. They're into what you're for. As long as you are for what they're for, they'll work and labor with you, but never think they are for you. If they meet somebody else who will further their agenda better than you're doing it, they will leave you and hook up with them in a second. Because they were never for you, they were what you were for, and by the time you get done falling in love with them, they will break your heart and hook up with somebody else who is for what they're for. You got to be careful who you tell your dream to. If you tell your dream to your constituents, they will leave you and try to fulfill your dream without you. If you find a few people in your life you can share your dream with, you are blessed. Can you say yes to that? So you have to learn to identify your confidants, people who are really for you. Look at somebody and say, I am for you. They will weep when you weep. They will rejoice when you rejoice. When you walk into a room and share good news, stop being happy for a minute and listen to their reaction. Confidants get happy when you share your dream. If they're not happy for you, shut the door and walk back out of the room. Yes? Look at somebody next to you and say, are you happy for me? Levi, are you happy for me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm happy for you too. Judas Iscariot was the textbook constituent. Look at the scriptures. Satan entered into Judas Iscariot. You know, he's one of the 12 disciples. Who was one of the 12 disciples? There's in the Bible. I didn't even need to do that. And he went, now key words here. You see, I highlighted them for you. I do that sometimes. And he went to the leading priests and captains of the temple guard to discuss the best way to betray Jesus to them. They didn't come to him and say, hey, Judas, can you help us betray Jesus? He, guys, is going to blow your mind. He went to them and said, let's discuss how, I'm an insider, let's discuss how we can betray the Son of God. Now look at this. So it says, they were delighted and they promised to give him money. So is a key word there. So why? So connected to the last sentence. So because they promised to give him money and they were delighted, he agreed and began looking for the opportunity to betray him. So because of what? Opportunity. The constituent is looking for opportunity. What Judas Iscariot did was he saw, and which by the way, we talk about the Bread of Life discourse when we talk which I was just referencing to you a second ago. This sermon is a tide shifter in the life and ministry of Jesus while he was here on earth. He was popular. We teach in Bible college the days of popularity. You guys who've gone through Bible college know. But then there is the final days of Jesus' ministry. There's a shift away from popularity, and now Jesus starts to be hunted by the people who want to crucify him. And Judas clearly recognized this shift. And Judas said, there's a greater opportunity. He felt like the momentum Christ had was starting to go down and the momentum of the Pharisees was picking up, and he jumped ship into the other basket. You with me? So I'm going to show you a couple things here. In John 12:6, describing Judas, Judas was mad because, remember, the woman was pouring out the perfume on the feet of Jesus. And remember what Judas said? Well, you know, we could have taken that money and we could have given it to the poor. Watch out for people like that. Watch out. I've seen those people over the years. Watch out for people like that. Because the Bible says it was not that he cared for the poor. He was a thief. And since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole some for himself. Look at this. Even my close friend. This is Psalms 41 referencing Judas Iscariot. Someone I trusted, someone who shared my bread, has turned against me. Judas felt like the Pharisees had greater momentum and Jesus is going down, so Judas shifted his alliance for opportunity. Do you think I'm stretching the Bible here? Does it seem crystal clear this is what's going on? Yes, I believe that too. So people do this all the time. This is the opposite of loyalty. This is betrayal. Loyalty says, if the ship goes down, I'll go down with it. If you have to beg your friends and church members to love you and stay with you and keep believing in you, then you have the wrong friends. Jesus did not beg constituents to walk with him. When they got up and walked away, he didn't come back and say, hey, please come back, please come back, please come back to me. He let him go. He turned to the 12 and said, will you go also? I think Jesus understood something. If people are with you, they're really with you. If they're not with you, there's very little you can do to convince them to be with you. So the point is, don't spend your life begging everyone to love you, to like you, to follow you, to believe in you. Right? Okay. Because God will bless you with some good confidants in your life. You know, be with your friends on their worst days. Take persecution with them. Lowell and Robert, I remember several years ago, I was in the middle of a situation where I was getting hacked to pieces by a couple of people. And I remember Robert stood up in the middle of that meeting and said, enough! I mean, it was like somebody, of course, some of those people said, that was just so out of character. I can't believe he acted like that. Yeah, well, Peter cut off an ear. Hey, man, listen. Listen, I kind of wrote it down to make sure I say it right. Take the persecution with someone. Tell someone off for your friends. Parentheses, repent later. LOL. But really, Peter did cut off an ear. We all focus on the three denials, but what about the sword to the ear? Peter was saying, I'm with you, Jesus. Come on, guys. I don't want anybody cutting off ears on my behalf, but man, sometimes it just feels good to know that people are with you. And sometimes if you're going to be a good friend, you need to make a stand with your friends. Amen. I know there could be some debates over that, but I think I'm within good doctrine. Super friends are always searching for ways to prove the full extent of their love or their loyalty, their commitment. I remember a couple years ago, Betty, when your mom passed away. And I remember Robert, Lola, Emily, and I were sitting here talking about how much Betty does for everyone in the church. She visits everyone. And Betty lost her mom, and she was down there all by herself, all the way down in Savannah, Georgia. And we were just like, you know what? Let's just get in the car right now. Let's drive to Savannah. Lola, we went there and came back the same day. We didn't even stay overnight, did we? Oh, we might have spent one night. Of course, in Savannah, Georgia, yes. We go down there, Betty, I'll never forget that moment. We walked in and you turned around and you started crying and we hugged. It was such an awesome moment. Every good friend should look for moments. Doesn't have to be every day, but for moments that you can just blow the mind of a friend and say, there's an expression of loyalty and love. Can you say yes to that? I know we're all busy. I tweeted this a while back. I heard someone else say something similar to this. Life is busy. I can't do for everyone, but I do for one what I wish I could do for many. Look for the opportunity to prove it to someone. Man, I wish I could stay in that because I'm really feeling it. Trait number two is positive contribution. Positive contribution. Listen, whether you believe it or not, the company you keep has more to do with you reaching your destiny than anything else. The company you keep. If your friendships are antagonistic, you will be shrunk down to a fraction of the person you could become. If your friendships are synergistic, in other words, you've got the right friends around you, you'll become 10 times what you could have become. with the level of skill, with the level of experience you have. Put the right people around you, and they'll make you better than you are. That's what John Maxwell says. You make me better than I am. What a great phrase, yes? Look at somebody and say that right now. You make me better than I am. AJ, I saw that Facebook comment. Thank you. No, I'm not omniscient or omnipresent. I have notifications. Superhero example. Here's a superhero example of synergy in relationships. Here it is. The Wonder Twin Powers. Go for it.
Our story begins at Pete's Ping Pong Parlor.
Old Zan is a champ when it comes to ping pong.
Looks like Gleek made the champ a chump. Uh-oh, the team trouble alert.
Metropolis Airstrip calling the Wonder Twins. Two teen boys took a plane for a joyride. The engine is faulty, the plane's radio is dead, and we can't warn them of the danger.
Wonder Twin powers activate! Shape of an eagle!
Form of water!
Yeah, I used to love the Wonder Twin Powers when I was a kid. It's just the funnest thing. Wonder Twin Powers activate. It's just, and you know, they invented the bump. Boom, there it was, man. All the way back in the day, we didn't even know it was there. We just discovered it in this generation. It's just so cool. But just such a great example. When the two of them they needed each other to release their power. And I think that's the way it is with friendships. There are people God will put in your life that'll make you better than you could ever be by yourself. Another reason to not be a hermit. Now, let me give you a couple of examples from the Bible. Can two walk together except they be agreed? What is the assumed answer? No. In other words, if you're in antagonism, you can't walk together. You don't have to agree with everyone. But if you want to make somebody a close friend, you better have some of the same philosophy about life. He who walks with wise men will be wise, but a companion of fools will be destroyed. Proverbs 30, verse 20. Proverbs 22, 24, do not befriend angry people or associate with hot-tempered people, or you will learn to be like them and you will endanger your soul. My wife used to tell me this when we first got married. She would say, I'm going to leave you. She said, I'm going to leave you. You're a hot-tempered man. Because what happened was Emily was so calm-natured when we first got married, but by necessity of having to like man up, I turned her into like a real hard person for a while, and then I finally started working on my character and getting nicer, and then when the fights took place, she'd win. And I remember it was the hardest thing when I was trying to learn humility. I was like, this is terrible. Now I got to be humble. Now I got to let her win a bunch of fights so that we both level out and we learn how to fight like, you know, nice. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? But she used to use that one on me all the time. Look at this one. You've had enough. This is so good here. This is in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 3. You've had enough in the past of the evil things that godless people enjoy, their immorality and lust. You, Christian people, have had enough of that, right? Their feasting and drunkenness and wild parties and their terrible worship of idols. Of course, your former friends, say that again, former friends. The Bible uses the term former friends. Are surprised when you no longer plunge into a flood of wild and destructive things they do, so they slander you. I wrote in my notes, if you want to go up in life, you must have former friends. Yeah. It's tough, isn't it? Former friends. Not to be confused with disloyalty, sometimes you have to walk away from those who are never going to head in the direction you're heading. Over the years, as I wanted to go on and change the world, I had a lot of people that didn't want to do that. And I'm not saying that every person that you have as a friend has to like go change the world. You can have chill people and you're out there being all hyper with yourself. It's not a matter of that, but there were some people that wanted to live just on a much lower level in their walk with God. When I'd hang out with them, they'd bring me down. I'm not trying to say I'm self-righteous, but I'm talking about your core. And it just felt like sometimes some of the people in my life were like, you know, the only way to keep a crab in the bucket is to put two crabs in a bucket because one will always pull the other one back down. And there were people that just every time I'd hang out, I'd walk away going, man, I don't like the person I am when I'm with them. It was come on, am I talking to anybody? It was antagonism. sometimes it's a hard thing to recognize that. I'm not saying you call them up and go, hey, dude, we're not going to hang out anymore because you're antagonistic to me. I'm going on with my life. You're a loser, and I'm going to move on. No, I'm not saying you do that. But you just recognize it, and you naturally shift into another direction. I wrote in my book about this, about running. I use a running analogy. If you're running and you're an 8-minute runner and you're running with a 9-minute runner, man, you can run for a little while, but both people are going to be frustrated because one's running slower, which can cause injury when you're conditioned for a faster race and you run back because you're on the track longer, you're on the course longer. The other person's running to keep up with the other person and both are frustrated. Sometimes in life you have to say to somebody, dude, I'm out of breath. Run your race, right? I don't know, man. I know I've given you a lot to think about. I can tell in certain moments, reaction. I can tell people are like, I got to process that. I got to process that. Be selective when you choose your inner friends. Was Jesus selective when he chose his inner friends? Definitely say yes, because he prayed all night long. He came down off the mountain and he said, you. Can you imagine all the people were frustrated when Jesus did? What about me? Jesus must not love me. God selected people. I can't believe it. Doesn't he love all of his children? But when Jesus was on earth, he understood this. He chose the 12 people that he would have his most private conversations with. She gives me chills thinking about it. Not just that, he chose 3 from the 12 that were his inner core. The ones that he brought another level higher wherever he was. They were there on the Mount of Transfiguration. They were there whenever Jesus went to raise a child from the dead. They were the ones that were there with Jesus in the closest moments. John was there at the foot of the cross when Jesus even said to Mary, mother, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. He turned his mom over to this one disciple. Can you imagine being chosen in all of the earth as the one Jesus loved so much that Jesus said, I want you to care for my mom. That's awesome. Not everybody got that privilege. It's okay to be selective. Listen, go out there and change the world. Make yourself available to everyone. Never feel like you're too good to bend down and help anyone and everyone. What I'm preaching about in this sermon is your inner circle, your core, the people you're gonna draw strength with and you're gonna give strength to. Amen. I know I'm preaching the truth. If you don't like it, don't call me. I'll be at the beach. Kristen will be returning all of your messages. Okay, so let me see. I'm just going to skip some stuff here. Slide 23, you guys. Become less antagonistic. Repair your identity, your personality, and your character, and step up in your walk with God. These are ways that you can improve yourself as a friend. Right? Because some people will say, well, let me say this. Eliminate irritants, defects, and flaws. Those things that greatly hinder your ability to relate with other people. Do you want to be a good friend? Find ways to become less antagonistic. Amen. Some people say, well, I am who I am. Take it or leave it. I said that last Sunday also. That is not the attitude of a rising legend. You don't have to forfeit your individuality, but become more likable. Is there anything wrong with making personal improvements? No. Nothing at all, is there? So we can become better to be better friends. Trait number 3, brutal honesty. This is a real key to friendship, brutal honesty. Are you honest with your friends? Do you want honest friends? Some people, listen, God brought you an honest friend and you kicked him out of your life. But God wanted them there to show you some blind spots so you can get those fixed. Now, wounds from a sincere friend are better than the kisses from an enemy. Proverbs 27:6. Paul said this, godly sorrow leads to repentance. He said, I'm not sorry that I sent you that severe letter, though I was sorry at first and I knew how painful it was for you for a little while. Now I'm glad I sent it because it hurt you. But because of the pain it caused you to repent and change your ways, it's the kind of sorrow God wants people to have. So you're not harmed by us in any way. For this kind of sorrow, God wants us to experience, leads us away from sin and to salvation. There's no regret in that kind of sorrow. Yes? Isn't that a good verse? Listen, give acceptance to your friends, but believe they can be better. Look at your friend and say, I accept you. Come on. But I believe you can be better. And when necessary, I will tell you the truth. Now look back at them and say, please do. Hey, man, here's the deal. Super friends are encouragers, but not flatterers. Flattery is poison. Flattery is like, it's like mace in the eyes. It blinds people. I'm not asking you to be flattered, to be a flatterer, but everyone has blind spots. There's areas in life they can't see. And you know what? It would be better to hear it from a friend than to be humiliated out there in the world by people who are not friends, by enemies. I'd rather have a friend look me in the eyes and say, you know, I remember one time a while back, Emily, I'm a words guy. Emily says to me, Bob, she goes, your breath is disgusting. I was like, are you serious? It hurt me so bad. I've never chewed more gum in that period of, thank you, Ann, I appreciate that. I've never brushed my teeth so much. I'm like, I brush my teeth 2 times a day. I got so offended. But she told me the truth. And it's a whole lot better for her to say it than for Levi to suffer all of his life while I'm straight up in his face. You got what I'm saying? Man, I hate the way sometimes it just comes out. Now I'm going to have to chew gum in this church the rest of my life. But, hey, man. Well, anyway. So that's what we want to do. Will you have courage? It takes courage to be a good friend. Why? Because if you look at a friend and you tell a friend the truth, there are consequences. I've had friends get very mad at me for trying to speak the truth to them. Do you know the worst thing about deception is not knowing you're deceived? People who are mentally handicapped and they're in another world. They don't know they're doing some of the stuff they're doing. You can try to rationalize. You can't rationalize with an irrational person. And people are blind. The Bible talks about spiritual blindness. So watch this. You go to a blind person and you tell them an area of their life, you say, you need to change. Well, if they knew they need to change, they probably would have changed. But they don't know they need to change. And you just hit them right between the eyes with the truth. They haven't considered. And I can promise you, in most cases, they're not going to say, hey, thank you, man. What I love about you is the way you're always brutally honest. I want to make a change right now. Let's pray about it. Will you pray me through? Pray me through this. Levi, I'm keeping my distance, you know, because of my breath. Right? So here's the deal. Will you face a few days' wrath from a friend in the hope that you will help them see the light? Come on. Will you? Say yes. That's what will make you a super friend, if you can face that wrath. Man, I know you're mad at me. You probably won't call me for a couple of days. But better are the wounds of a friend than the kisses of an enemy. I love you enough to tell you the truth. I'll be here when you stop getting mad, and you can call me back, and we'll go hang out. Right? Have you given your friends permission to speak the truth to you? I'm almost done. Trait number 4, loud admiration. Let's hear it for your friends, guys. We got good friends. Loud admiration. Now, I love this one. I'm a words of encouragement kind of guy. You can change my life. Roger and Phyllis took us out to lunch this last week. I love Roger and Phyllis. I tell you, Roger looks at me and says, I've been around the world. And I tell you, a compliment is only as good as the person behind it. He's a guy who's served in the military. He's been around the world. This guy has stories. He is like Walter Mitty. It's unbelievable the kind of life this guy's lived. And he looks at me and says, I've been around the world. I've been to all these different churches. He lived in Alaska. That's the ultimate cool factor. He's lived in Alaska. And he says, hearing messages like yours, he's telling me all this stuff. And I'm just like, oh, Roger. I'm like, stop. More. And he bought the lunch at the end of it. I was like, this is the greatest day of my life. Free lunch with all this encouragement. He basically stood in front of me. He stood up in the middle of the restaurant and said, this guy's awesome. Look at somebody next to you and say, this person's awesome. That's what good friends do. You know what? There's a lot of negativity coming against people to bring them down. Would you agree with that? Everyone needs a few good friends to trump the sounds of negativity with some good encouragement and some loud clapping. Amen. Super friends point out your strengths. You're awesome. You're smart. You're beautiful. You matter. You have talents. You have potential. I believe in you. I know your heart. That's a powerful thing to say to a friend. I know your heart. Yeah, I know you messed up. But I know your heart, and I'm still with you. I still believe in you. Man, you're still awesome. Don't be down on yourself too long. You made a mistake. You made a bad choice, but you're not a bad person. I know your heart. I know you better than anyone. Kristen said that to me before over the years, many times over the years. She says, I know you more than anyone, and I know your heart. I'd go to the ends of the earth. Man, you know what those kind of words mean to someone? I know you more than anyone or as much as anyone, and I believe in you. People need to hear that. Do you know what kind of depression and how many people are on the brink of suicide in this earth right now? Well, I don't want to lift them up in pride. I tell you, if you want to run a risk in over-encouraging people rather than under-encouraging people. I can tell you there's a lot more people in that danger than there is in this danger. This is a world, I don't meet very many prideful people anymore. I meet people who are so broken down. You know what they need? They need to be lifted up. They need a good friend to be like, I believe you to man, you to man, you to man, you to woman. Right? I'm almost done with this, so we're still going to get out of here just like I told you right before lunch. Amen. Be the person who claps the loudest on graduation day. Kelsey, our niece, Emily's niece, just graduated from UVA. Where's Al? UVA, she graduated with 2 degrees. She graduated, I forget what her degrees were, but it's just unbelievable. She's got a master's in something. And I mean, just, wow, what a great education. What a great quality girl. Everybody's clapping. You know how graduations are? Everybody's clapping. Every once in a while, I'll just be like, woo! You're like, oh, poor person, man. Wish I'd have known. I would have joined in and yelled for them. It's like a popularity contest. Come on, guys. Just don't tell me it's not. It is. And you, when you get your family together, you look at each other and be like, you ready for this? It is game on, man. It is game on. Here it comes. I had so many butterflies in my stomach when it came on. I yelled so hard. Normally, I'm the loudest one yelling. We had Jack and Ross and some of these other ones, distant relatives, they were yelling so loud I couldn't hear myself. Yeah, I was like, full blast, and all I heard was silence. It was like it went to like loud decibels to like silent. It was like we were in another realm of yelling. We won. She graduated with the highest honors that day because she had loud fans, and that's a good feeling. She said when she went to receive her reward, that the dean said, wow, you've got some fans. Come on, guys. That's the way your life should be. Man, I believe in you guys. I hope you believe in me. This is what we do for each other. Super friends are fast to say, this calls for celebration. Right? Amen. You guys are ready for me to be done. I could tell. That amen was just like, lunchtime. I promise, you don't have to spend your life with grouchy, negative people, with haters, begging, please believe in me. I promise there are enough people out there who will love you and cheer for you. Amen? Amen. But if you want to get it started, start doing that for everyone else. These traits you want to see in your friends, start to put these traits into your life. Give that to someone else and give, and it shall be given, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Let's stand today and let's pray. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we think about each of these relationship traits, God, each of these messages from each week, and we think about our relationship with you. God, I want you to look over the earth and say, Chuck is my friend. I want you to look over the earth and say, Destiny Family Center, man, those guys have the loudest admirers. Those people, man, they go for it. They love me. Those people walk in truth. Those people make positive contribution. Those people have firm loyalty to serving me. Lord, we want to be the friend of God. And we want to be a good friend to each other. Grab hands with somebody next to you. I don't normally do that because you know how people are with germs these days. But just grab hands with somebody next to you. And we have plenty of great antibacterial soap in the bathrooms. We are asking right now, Father, as we're just a sign of community, we're praying, Father, that you would move and that you would mend friendships today and that you would give us a lot to contemplate, that you would give us wisdom about who to befriend, about when it's time to demonstrate loyalty and when it's time to run the faster pace. Such a fine line. It's very difficult sometimes to figure out, but you'll give us wisdom. I ask you now, Father, to bless every person in this church with super friends. And I ask you now, Father, that you would make each one of us super friends. Do you want that grace on your life? I want it on my life. I apologize to everyone times I wasn't there for you, times I wasn't a good friend, times I wasn't honest, times I didn't cheer, times you thought, man, that guy has no loyalty, times I didn't contribute anything. And I vow today, God, that you would make me a better friend to people, less focused on myself and more focused on making a difference for the people around me. And we make this commitment together. We make this covenant together. Father, I pray that you heal us from all the times we were wounded by people. They didn't mean it. Pressure's got them. These people don't know how to act these days. We just offer mercy. We offer forgiveness. And we pray, God, that you would move in the lives of our friends today. We're not going to get into our destiny without the right people around us. And so now, Father, I ask you to put the right people around us. Amen, everyone? Father, we're asking right now. We're praying together. We're praying together right now. We're praying. This is altar time. We're praying together, God, that you'd move in our lives. We need people that we can synergize with, people that we can change the world with. Father, let this be a generation of those who seek the Lord. Let us be in the same culture with the same philosophy in life. Lord, that we would value others, that we would want to make a difference, Father. We'd get up every day hungry for God's presence. That, Lord, we would be good prayer partners. That we would give and contribute together. I pray now that you'd move in this church, Father, that you would increase synergy, unity. Again, as Aaron was talking about in worship, unity, Father, in this congregation. That there would be a greater outpouring of God's Spirit, because that's how to create synergy with God, that we would agree together, that we would walk together, that we would have unity. And it is there in unity, God, that you are drawn to us and we are drawn to you. I want to ask you real fast. I haven't done it in several weeks now, a couple of weeks. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, before you go home, will you please just give me a chance to pray with you, to lead you to Christ? If you've never given your life to Christ, or maybe you did years ago and you backslid, you walked away from God, and today you want to renew your relationship with Christ, I'm going to count to three, and when I do, I just want you to raise your hand real fast. One, two, three, raise your hand right now. Those of you who want to give your life to Christ, thank you. Who else? Want to give your life? Who else? Come on. Raise it up. Want to give your life to Christ right now. The balcony here on the floor. All right, now I want to lead you through this prayer right now. I want everybody to pray this prayer with me and mean it with all of your heart, please. Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you today and I confess I was born a sinner. I can't save myself. I'm separated from God, and I need a Savior. This day, I believe the Bible. When Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except through me. I believe in you, Jesus, and I ask you now, come into my heart, be the Lord of my life. Save me from my sins. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now let's thank God.